Hi, and welcome to Connected. I'm Tim Mulligan, president of Communities and Schools. And Connected is a podcast that explores that really vital connection between education and those community assets. You know, in the community, there's so many wonderful resources that can really help students to be successful in school. And today, as our guest, I'm really excited because we have, well, let me just say, anybody in the Lehigh Valley who knows education knows the name George White. George is the class of 61 professor at Lehigh University. He is the director of the Center for Developing Urban Educational Leaders. George has been really a leader in training educational leaders. And I know myself how much I value his wisdom and support in myself trying to be an educational leader. So George, welcome.
Thanks, Tim. I appreciate that kind opening. I really do. It's been nice to be able to. One of the rules of thumb is if you're around long enough, people remember your name, sometimes for good things, sometimes for not good things. So appreciate it.
Great. George, as I said a little bit in the opening, your career has been really interesting. You were not only a science teacher, a middle school principal, an administrator in a school district, before really jumping into this area of training educational leaders. Let me ask you this. What inspired you to be in that training role?
It's interesting. As I think back over my career, my first teaching position was a position in Cape May, New Jersey. I was a young 21-year-old science teacher, and I had a principal who exemplified all the things that we would say we would want to have in a building principal. He knew how to engage people. He was an outreach into the community. This was back in the late 70s when outreach into the community wasn't as important as it is today, or seen as important as it is today. And he, within the first 6 weeks, took me under his wing and talked about the fact that, you know, leaders don't just have to have a title. They are what people do and how people act. We had long conversations. So when I went off to graduate school, I went off to graduate school to learn about leadership, specifically in education. And so that started a long time interest in the development of leadership, originally looking at it very narrowly in relationship to schools. But now I look at it much more broadly in relationship to communities. And so when we talk about educational leaders, you're an educational leader, Tim, the work that you do. You're not a building principal, you're not a background in education, but the work that people in this community do to support the quality of education. And so we're now broadening our understanding of what that is and where we go with it.
You know, George, you know, you tapped on something really interesting. You know, I think a lot of times you see educational leaders who maybe work within their silos, and they, you know, a school district has a lot of resources. They have academic and non-academic resources. But I think we're seeing more and more a lot of great leaders are beginning to really see value in some of those assets in the community, as you talked about. What has prompted this kind of a shift? Is it necessity, or is it something else?
What really has happened is that the job of a building administrator, specifically a principal, has grown to such extent that it can't be done by one person any longer. And the principals who still think that they're the guy or gal on the white horse that rides in and saves the day are usually the ones that fail. The ones who really have success, whether we're talking in urban communities or rural communities, specifically in urban communities, are the ones who have learned the skill of being a good partner and developing good partnership. Mm-hmm. And when I went through my leadership training, there was nothing in there about that. It was making the trains run on time. It was building a master schedule, managing your budget, making sure the kids went to class when they were supposed to go to class, and some work on curriculum and instruction. Today, we build into our leadership prep program a strong emphasis that sort of is a connecting tissue that weaves its way through on what it means to be a good partner. Why does Tim Mulligan and Communities in School want to partner with Trexler Middle School or South Mountain Middle School or Central Elementary School or Roosevelt? why, and in many cases, it's because the principal has built a relationship that says, come on in, we're inclusive. We don't want you to do something to us, we want you to do something with us so that we can improve the quality. And it begins with the principal, because as you know, you've worked in places where the principal has sort of said, not in my house. And so that's what we're trying to understand more deeply. It is out of necessity to some extent, but it is also out of good visionary leadership. You know, it does take a community to educate a child. It's not just about what happens from 8 until 3. It's what happens from 5 until 9. And so the principal needs to be able to reach out and build on those assets that already exist.
Yeah, I like how you phrase that. It's not just what a partner does to a school or a community, but with. Okay. And I think it's that kind of collaborative spirit that's so important. So George, if you were to describe an educational, urban, let's talk about urban for a little bit. An urban educational leader. What are the arrows in the quiver that urban educational leader needs to be successful?
Well, number one, and probably most important, and the thing that we can't teach, is they have to have a passion for the work. This is hard work, and it's not a job. It's not even a profession. It really is. The best urban principals, the best urban superintendents have a calling. It is, and that passion is what we look for at the front end of the input, throughput, output model. Once we have that, then what we're looking for is, are they open to new ideas? Are they open to working with others? We use a very strong model that is supported highly in the Lehigh Valley on collective impact. And in order for collective impact to work, the leadership has to basically tell everyone in the organization, it's not about you, it's about us, and it's about what happens with, in a school model, what happens with the children and their families. So begins with passion. Second is an openness to new ideas, to working with others, to realizing and that you're not always the smartest person in the room. That the best principals, the best superintendents are the ones who seek people who can help them solve problems that they on their own cannot solve. And then I think the third piece is that there is a creative and innovative spirit among them, that they don't look at a problem as a problem, they look at it as an opportunity. They look at it as a way to maybe steer a little bit in one direction and a steer in a little bit in a different direction. So when you see high-performing urban school communities working, what happens in one school is a little different than what's happening in another school. A, the clientele is different. B, the leadership brings different partners together, and that requires them to solve problems in different ways. So I would say passion, openness, and innovation are the three. Now notice, I didn't talk at all about budgets, schedules, curriculum. Yeah. Those are the teachable things. We can teach all of those things. Yeah. Those other things, we're looking for kernels that say, that's the kind of person. So you hear all the time, are leaders born or made? And the answer is both. There has to be some foundational beliefs and understanding that we can then build off of. And then I can teach people how to build a master schedule. But if they're creative and flexible, this month they build the schedule this way. But next month, because something else is happening, they may have to modify that. That's what we're looking for.
Yeah. And I like how you said that too about that truly is a vocation and a calling to be that urban educational leader. And you also hit upon something real interesting, collective impact. One of the things that's always been so appealing to me about this whole collective impact framework is it's really a way of addressing cross-sectoral problems. And you know, I think great leaders realize that, you know, if we're trying to increase third grade reading, it's not as simple as just let's get the kids into tutoring.
Right.
There are all kinds of other obstacles and barriers. Sometimes they're academic, but sometimes non-academic, maybe even more important than non-academic barriers.
Yeah.
And you know, what are some of the unique challenges of an urban educational leader in addressing some of those very complex issues that include non-academic barriers?
So this is where the idea of context and situational leadership comes to bear.
Right.
What I mean by that is, what's happening in Bethlehem, in an elementary school in Bethlehem, may look pretty similar to what's happening in an elementary school in Allentown or in Easton. And in some cases, it may look similar to what's happening in an elementary school in Bangor. But the nuancing of understanding that this clientele may need different experiences and different opportunities, and having the principal or the superintendent be able to understand that and find the resources necessary. So some of those barriers that we see existing to third grade reading, for example, or high school graduation, has to do with transitory nature of your population, right? We know, I'm the lead partner for two, my center is the lead partner for two community schools, and you and I work together closely on those. In one of my community schools, we have almost a 65% turnover rate. That means the kids that are with us the first day of school, by the end of school, we may turn that population over 65%. And so no matter what we do, we're only seeing some of those kids for a short period of time, right? Mm-hmm. So what is it that we do? Are schools the reason that the turnover rate is occurring? Probably not. Mm-hmm. What we've come to believe and study through my center, the Center for Developing Urban Educational Leaders, is that housing opportunities. Families don't want to move. They have to move in many cases. And then job opportunities, right? What does the community provide? Are there work potential? So if we can keep a kid in school, in the same school, assuming that the school is doing the right work, because that's the education side. But if we can keep that student in that school for multiple years, we have the possibility of the multiplier effect. Each year we build on our growth from the year before. If, however, the kid this past year was in three different schools, and this year he's in our school and then two other schools, the downtime and the startup time gets in the way. So one of our biggest issues that we're working on right now to help third grade on grade level reading by third grade or to help graduation rates is improving quality of housing stock, number one, the opportunity for people to stay in their homes. And so that requires the school and the community to do some interesting things. In Brockle and Donegan, we're now on the south side of Bethlehem developing a jobs fair with some of our local and regional businesses. Yeah. For the families, so this is, you talk about leadership. This is a principal saying, I can't hire those people, but I can be a conduit to bring the Sands and the hospital and the local banks and the tech industries together under one roof, and with the community college to say, we have a workforce that you may need. And if we can get those families jobs, then they can be stable in their homes.
Yeah.
Right? So that's a key piece that people typically don't think about as the school leader's role, but a school leader who really wants to have longer term impact, that's the collective impact piece. They're not doing it. They're facilitating it. They're being open. They're using their space. And that's happening for us next week. We're having a big jobs fair.
Yeah, and George, those are some of the real exciting things that, you know, we see throughout the Lehigh Valley is seemingly disconnected sectors are beginning to talk to each other and realize that they're very connected.
Yeah.
Housing, academic success, nutrition, careers, you know, and you know, just there's so many interconnections that that good educational leaders on every level, whether it's building level, district level, regional level, are really trying to help facilitate and bring these folks together in that collective impact framework.
Yeah, so let me give you another example. One of the benefits of being in the Lehigh Valley is we have an amazing higher education community. Mm. Two really world-class community colleges, Northampton and LTRIC, who have both put footprints and a flag in the ground to say, not too far from this office, there is the LTRIC at downtown Allentown campus. And not too far from my two community schools, there is a flag in the ground for Northampton. And both of those presidents are committed and working actively. We then have Cedar Crest, DeSales, the other L school, Lafayette,
as my alma mater.
As we're taping prior to the week before the Lehigh Lafayette game. Muhlenberg and Moravian, all of whom have one major resource that schools need. And they have passionate, educated kids who are between the ages of 18 and 21 who serve as excellent role models. The role of a leader in the community, a leader in the school, is to harness that so that it is aligned, that resource. So at Lehigh, we have between Brockel Middle School and Donegan Elementary School, we had last year over 120 students who donated time as tutors and as homework club supporters. But we didn't just throw them to the wolves. The leader said, the principals said, you know, we want these people to be aligned with what we're doing in the classroom. So we do professional development for our teachers, for our tutors. And what we've seen is by that simple little act, the tutoring was happening, but by aligning it, all of a sudden, we've seen major growth taking place. We also see our tutors, some of whom are chemical engineers, some of whom are biology people or English people, now saying, you know what? I think I could do this as a career. And so these very bright and talented students who we've exposed, so it's a win-win. The student gains, the Lehigh student, the Lafayette student, the Moravian student, the Cedar Crest student gains, but so do the kids in the school. And the benefit of that is that they have these role models who are close to their age,
right,
who are saying it's okay to be a scholar and an athlete, or a scholar and someone in theater, or a scholar and music, but scholar is important. And so the principles, the difference, as I said earlier, is the ability to know when to reach out, how to be open, but yet how to coordinate that work is a critical skill that we're now learning that we have to actually teach emerging principles.
Yeah. You know, George, as you were talking, I was just thinking about how one of the critical roles of any good leader is to make leaders, you know, to raise up the folks around you to take on that kind of leadership, to empower them to fulfill that clearly set vision and mission. And you know, what you were talking about just now is a great example of that. You know, investing in the tutors who are themselves that, you know, school level leadership, and to, you know, empower them to do what they're doing as well as that can be done.
I go back to my beginning. I'm a 21-year-old teacher in Cape May, New Jersey, and Jerry Darlington, who was the principal, who I thought was ancient at the time, he was probably 38 or 40, took me under his wing and said, you know, this is what we're here for. This is the vision. He shares it one-on-one. And so one of the things that we build into our leadership preparation program at Lehigh is that, and we've had a wonderful partnership here in Allentown, where we've trained 18 new building administrators over the last 5 years, is that whole idea that you lead to grow other leaders, whether that's a third grade student who you see leadership capability and potential in and you start to nurture it and develop it. The Leader in Me program is a perfect example of that. Right? And the Valley has embraced that too. And how they've done that. Every kid has leadership capabilities in them, but the principal who then leads his or her teachers and the helps to lead parents and community members. You can always tell an effective principal by the number of volunteers that want to be part of and how those volunteers are utilized. So that notion, we call it in the business, succession planning. It's who are you developing? They may not take your job. They may not even take a job in your district. And they may stay in the classroom for 40 years and be an amazing leader,
right?
But how are you developing them so that they are doing the kind of work that allows us to pull multiple disparate groups together and organizations together in a way that we create, I'm a science teacher, so synergism, where the whole is truly greater than the sum of its parts, is what collective impact is all about. It's based on a scientific principle that says, you bring skills that I don't have, I bring skills that you don't have, and if we can find a way to mesh those seamlessly, then what happens is 2 + 2 = 5, it no longer equals 4. And that's what we're really trying to accomplish.
Yeah. You know, George, one of the, we've talked about collective impact and, situational leadership, which is so very important too. One of the things that I've often seen and, really admire in great leaders is the ability to not only create a clear vision, but to communicate that vision. And, sometimes we see dysfunctional systems where anybody would have a hard time saying what is the vision and where's everyone going, and sometimes the result is disparate energies going different places. But that good educational leader, and again, building level or whatever, can harness energy and can get people excited about the vision and get everybody moving in the same direction.
Yeah. So I know you've just had Joe Roy on, Dr. Roy.
Perfect example, yeah.
Who, by the time his taping comes out, it will have been announced that he's the superintendent of the year in the state of Pennsylvania. And one of the reasons that he's been identified for that is, and I know you spent a lot of time on the roadmap, is the roadmap is the vision.
Yeah,
I mean, the roadmap lays out clearly what's important and helps people understand what we're going to do and why it's important, but also what we're not going to do, and because we can't do everything,
right?
And the ability to put that roadmap out, and what are we at, version 4.0 now?
4.0, yeah.
I remember when it was version 1, and he and Jack Silva had just come to the table and started to work with the board and have them understand it. It was a galvanizing document. It was the ability for people to come together and have something to talk about. And in some cases, disagree, and in some cases, nuance. But good leaders provide that rallying point. We call it a vision of what this place could look like. And so as I teach our future school leaders, we talk about effective visions are futures-oriented, they're aspirational, and they're inspirational. Mm. And the best ones are the ones that rally people around for conversation, because now it becomes shared vision, not my vision.
Right?
And so we see lots of examples of leaders who say, my way, this is me, this is how I want to do it. The truly effective leaders, long-term effective leaders, are the ones who use we and ours, and we collectively agree that this is where we're going. We may not always agree on the route that we're taking. I use with my students the planning a vacation idea.
Yeah.
We're agreeing we're going to San Francisco. How my sister gets there and how I get there may be very different. I may take a road trip and she may fly, but we're eventually going to be at that meeting point. And that's what good leaders do. So they allow elementary school A to have some decisions in how they're going to get to everybody on third grade level reading. But they don't allow them to say, nah, some kids aren't going to make it, right? That's the effective leader. And so we have multiple examples at the building level, at the community level, at the United Way level, of leadership that is, it is aspirational, inspirational, and futures oriented. It's the dog track mentality where the bunny is, and you never catch the bunny. Mm-hmm. Roadmap next year will be roadmap 4.4 or 5.0, because you want to constantly be stretching people to move forward.
Yeah. Excellent. Great. George, when you think about, you know, in the 5 years I've been at communities and schools, and you know, it's, you never have to wait a day or two before something is in the newspaper and some headline, a calamity going on regarding an urban school district. You know, being an urban, especially on a superintendent level, that's a really tough job. Yep. You know, you're under-resourced, you're overexposed to the media, you're constantly, you've got a target on you all the time. Sometimes it concerns me that who would want these jobs? You know, you're stepping into, you're not stepping into maybe an incredible situation with a lot of supports. Sometimes you have to find those supports, and you have to, as you said, you have to be so single-minded, and this is your calling. What do you see for the future of urban educational leadership, and how can we inspire more great leaders to take on these tremendous challenges?
So first of all, let me just clarify just a bit that what you describe for urban superintendents are the same pressures that suburban and rural superintendents are under, but they're different types of pressures. So if you happen to be the superintendent in Parkland, you have a clientele who has different needs and different expectations, and in some cases are much more verbal about those needs and expectations and are much more demanding in those needs and expectations. Mm-hmm. And if you're in a rural community like Penn Argyl or Bangor, the scarceness of resources there compared to Allentown, we're talking resources now, not just dollars.
Right.
They don't have five colleges and universities or seven colleges and universities.
Yeah, great point.
And so when I talk about situational leadership, understanding that being successful in Bangor doesn't translate to being successful in Allentown, nor does being successful in Allentown translate to being successful in Penn Argyl or in Parkland. Right. So I think that's an important piece. And right. that was an aha moment for me in my early stages of development at Lehigh as a faculty member. We had, when I came to Lehigh, a one-size-fits-all model. We trained you to be a superintendent. We trained you to be a principal anywhere. Mm. And what we began to realize is that we had misfits. We'd get somebody who had a K-12 principal certificate, and they'd end up working in Parkland when their heart and their passion was working with kids who had different types of needs, and they'd struggle in Parkland. And they'd come over to work in Bethlehem, and they'd thrive. And vice versa,
yeah.
Right? So I think that's a key point. Now, there are some unique challenges about being in urban communities. By the way, the average lifespan of an urban superintendent in the United States is 2.6 years, right?
Yeah.
Lifespan career-wise or job-wise in that district. Yeah. And part of that is because they are, in most regions, the urban school district is the hub of the media, the hub of business and industry, so they are the place where the spotlight is typically turned on brightest.
Right.
And so learning how to deal with those pressures requires the best of the best to know how to do that outreach and to build those relationships and to communicate with parents and teachers in a way that the Bangor superintendent may not have to do. The Bangor superintendent may be able to go to the Grange and meet everybody because that's the local meeting place. In Allentown, there are multiple local meeting places. Mm-hmm. So the nature of the job is, A, it's highly intensive. B, it is always under the spotlight. And C, we have to bring in the idea that poverty creates a whole set of other issues. Trauma for our students, trauma for our families, There are race-related issues that result here that you, although we do see them in other suburban school districts, but to less extent because there's less diversity. The right. diversity of a community raises the difference in terms of expectations of the various members of the community. A white, upper middle class, highly educated family has a set of an understanding and a set of expectations. Doesn't mean that the families who are not college educated don't have high expectations for their kids. They just look different in terms of their expectation. And the superintendent then has not one clientele, but multiple clientels. So that makes it very difficult. I can continue to come back to this idea that if you think you can do it by yourself, you're going to fail. Probably some of the most successful urban superintendents, Tom Passant in Boston, was a superintendent who immediately built strong coalitions with business, industry, the churches, and they weren't just in name only, they were active. He nurtured them, he supported them, and he stayed for 12 years. And Boston made a turnaround, not in year one or two, or even in year three. It takes time, right? And so think about what I said, 2.6 years average tenure. What kind of change takes place in 2.6 years?
Yeah.
Right? It's very difficult.
You know, George, I recently saw another data point on superintendents in Pennsylvania, and I believe the number was 8 years, and less than 20% of superintendents stayed 8 years.
Yep.
Which again goes to that point of longevity, and you know, when you have a leader facing significant issues, you know, can we be patient to see change?
And well, and part of it is, and I put myself at risk here a little bit, but part of it is the idea that school districts are run and operated by school boards who change every 4 years,
right.
and really change on a 2 year basis because they're rolling elections. And people who are well-intended, good-hearted, but are volunteers who are not experts in the field. And I use this analogy all the time. Would you want Apple Computer's board of directors to not understand business or technology? And yet you can be elected to a school board position in the state of Pennsylvania with not a high school diploma. You don't. There are no requirements for education, and so the effective school leaders know how to provide support and education for their boards when they get elected.
Right.
And that's my colleague Dr. Donahue at Lehigh teaches our superintendents program, and there is a strong component to. How do you help your board be the best board that they can be? We don't hear people talk about that in business schools. They don't have to talk about how do we help the board at General Motors be a good board.
Right.
That's not part of the CEO's job. In school districts, it has to be. Mm-hmm. And again, that's another component of education that if it's not managed well, what happens is boards start to be infighting because they're representing various constituent groups in their community. And now the superintendent's spending more of his time or her time internally than working with the community, the teachers, the building, and building that base.
Yeah.
We've been fortunate in the region that we have, and I would say this predominantly across the country, for the majority of people who run and are elected to school boards, they are well-minded, caring individuals who want schools to be better. That's the first stage. But there are some other steps along the way. What does that mean? How does the superintendent help them understand and own the vision? And how do we provide stability? Now, I studied the Quakertown School District a number of years ago, and their board was one of the most stable boards in the state. They had board members, the average tenure on their board, this was about 8 years ago when I did the study, had 14 years of experience on their board.
Wow.
Right? Those folks knew education. They understood their role and the role of the superintendent. They understood that they weren't supposed to be going in and observing classes and providing feedback. That's not their job. But I talked to the superintendent who had been there, and he said it took the work and work with the community. You get the right people, and these people were passionate and committed. So I'm not sure that that's perfect, but I also know that changing board members every 2 years is not perfect. And, you know, so somewhere in between, and the superintendent has a responsibility, as do we as community members, to say, you know, who should be on our school board? Because it's a big job. I mean, in this district, talking millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars budget and people's lives. In many school districts or many communities, the school district is the second or third largest employer, right? We
That's right.
So they, the superintendent is the CEO, and in an urban district, the spotlight is always on them.
Well, great. George, as we kind of wind down this this segment, what gives you the most hope regarding tomorrow's educational leaders?
Yeah, one of the benefits and one of the joys of my job is that I see who's coming up in the pipeline. And we have some amazingly talented, passionate individuals who are wanting to learn in this district. Within probably half a mile of here are some of the, I believe, truly talented principals who at the age of 29 or 30 are running a school. But their passion and their vision for what it could be for that school. So I'm hopeful, I'm very hopeful that with the work that we're doing in a place like Allentown or a place like Bethlehem or a place like Easton, where we've shown the value of that collective impact, where partners have stepped up to the table and said, yeah, we want to be in, and it's not about us, it's about what can we do together, that opens the door for future principals, people who are currently teachers, to look and say, yeah, I think I could do that job. I would like to do that job. Yeah. And we have some administrators in these districts who are tapping people on the shoulder and saying, you know what, you have the potential to do that job.
Yeah,
I would tell you, 10 years ago, I wasn't as hopeful because I thought the job was getting totally out of hand. But I'm very hopeful today that education is moving in the right direction. And partners, our business partners in the Allentown community, the Downtown Allentown Community Development Initiative, that group of folks are passionate about education. Because as one of them said to me the other day, our Allentown is only going to be as good as our Allentown School District is. And so that gives me hope that they, the leaders, the business leaders in the community, see the importance of all of us working together.
Well, George, I just want to thank you for this conversation. We could continue to talk about this for hours.
And we have.
And I have to say, after this podcast, I feel inspired. I feel inspired by the great work that people like yourself are doing in education. A podcast like this wouldn't have even made sense 10 years ago.
Yeah, you're right.
Talking about education and the community assets and connections. But today it does, because leaders are seeing with that kind of vision and saying, what can we do to help our kids be successful?
And I appreciate that.
So, George, I really appreciate you being here today. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
And thanks to all of you for viewing our podcast. And stay tuned for next episodes of Connected.